on the Holy Trinity and of the Godhead of the Holy Spirit, to Eustathius by Gregory of Nyssa. To Eustathius, all you who study medicine have, one may say, humanity for your profession, and I think that one who preferred your science to all the serious pursuits of life would form the proper judgment and not miss the right decision, if it be true that life, the most valued of all things, is a thing to be shunned and full of pain, if it may not be had with health, and health your art supplies. But in your own case, the science is in a notable degree of double efficacy. You enlarge for yourself the bounds of its humanity, since you do not limit the benefit of your art to men's bodies, but take thought also for the cure of troubles of the mind. I say this not only following the common reports, but because I have learnt it from experience, as in many other matters, so especially at this time, in this indescribable malice of our enemies, which you skilfully dispersed when it swept like some evil flood over our life, dispelling this violent inflammation of our heart by your fomentation of soothing words. I thought it right, indeed, in view of the continuous and varied effort of our enemies against us, to keep silence, and to receive their attack quietly, rather than to speak against men armed with falsehood, that most mischievous weapon, which sometimes drives its point even through truth. But you did well in urging me not to betray the truth, but to refute the slanderers, lest by a success of falsehood against truth many might be injured. I may say that those who conceived this causeless hatred for us seemed to be acting very much on the principle of Aesop's fable. For just as he makes his wolf bring some charges against the lamb, feeling ashamed, I suppose, of seeming to destroy without just pretext one who had done him no hurt, and then, when the lamb easily swept away all the slanderous charges brought against him, makes the wolf by no means slacken his attack, but carry the day with his teeth when he is vanquished by justice, so those who were as keen for hatred against us as if it were something good, perhaps feeling some shame of seeming to hate without cause, make up charges and complaints against us, while they do not abide consistently by any of the things they say, but allege now that one thing, after a little while that another, and then again after that something else is the cause of their hostility to us. Their malice does not take a stand on any ground, but when they are dislodged from one charge they cling to another, and from that again they seize upon a third, and if all their charges are refuted they do not give up their hate. They charge us with preaching three gods, and din into the ears of the multitude this slander, which they never rest from maintaining persuasively. Then truth fights on our side, for we show both publicly to all men, and privately to those who converse with us, that we anathematize any man who says that there are three gods, and hold him to be not even a Christian. Then, as soon as they hear this, they find Sabellius a handy weapon against us, and the plague that he spread is the subject of continual attacks upon us. Once more, we oppose to this assault our wonted armour of truth, and show that we abhor this form of heresy just as much as Judaism. What then? Are they weary after such efforts and content to rest? Not at all. Now they charge us with innovation and frame their complaint against us in this way. They allege that while we confess three persons, we say that there is one goodness and one power and one Godhead. And in this assertion they do not go beyond the truth, for we do say so. But the ground of their complaint is that their custom does not admit this, and Scripture does not support it. What then is our reply? We do not think that it is right to make their prevailing custom the law and rule of sound doctrine. For if custom is to avail for proof of soundness, we too surely may advance our prevailing custom, and if they reject this, we are surely not bound to follow theirs. Let the inspired Scripture, then, be our umpire, and the vote of truth will surely be given to those whose dogmas are found to agree with the divine words. Well, what is their charge? There are two brought forward together in the accusation against us, one that we divide the persons, the other that we do not employ any of the names which belong to God in the plural number, but, as I said already, speak of the goodness as one, and of the power, and the Godhead, and all such attributes in the singular. With regard to the dividing of the persons, those cannot well object who hold the doctrine of the diversity of substances in the divine nature. For it is not to be supposed that those who say that there are three substances do not also say that there are three persons. So this point only is called in question, that those attributes which are ascribed to the divine nature we employ in the singular. But our argument in reply to this is ready and clear. For anyone who condemns those who say that the Godhead is one must necessarily support either those who say that there are more than one, or those who say that there is none. But the inspired teaching does not allow us to say that there are more than one, since whenever it uses the term, it makes mention of the Godhead in the singular, as, "In him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead," and elsewhere, "The invisible things of him from the foundation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead." If then, to extend the number of the Godhead to a multitude belongs to those only who can suffer from the plague of polytheistic error, and on the other hand, utterly to deny the Godhead would be the doctrine of atheists, what doctrine is that which accuses us for saying that the Godhead is one? But they reveal more clearly the aim of their argument. As regards the Father, they admit the fact that he is God, and that the Son, likewise, is honoured with the attribute of Godhead, but the Spirit, who is reckoned with the Father and the Son, they cannot include in their conception of Godhead, but hold that the power of the Godhead, issuing from the Father to the Son, and their halting, separates the nature of the Spirit from the divine glory. And so, as far as we may in short space, we have to answer this opinion also. What then is our doctrine? The Lord, in delivering the saving faith to those who become disciples of the Word, joins with the Father and the Son the Holy Spirit also, and we affirm that the union of that which has once been joined is continual, for it is not joined in one thing and separated in others, but the power of the Spirit being included with the Father and the Son in the life-giving power by which our nature is transferred from the corruptible life to immortality, and in many other cases also, as in the conception of good and holy and eternal, wise, righteous, chief, mighty, and in fact everywhere, has an inseparable association with them in all the attributes ascribed in a sense of special excellence. And so we consider that it is right to think that that which is joined to the Father and the Son in such sublime and exalted conceptions is not separated from them in any way. For we do not know of any differences by way of superiority and inferiority in attributes which express our conceptions of the divine nature, so that we should suppose it an act of piety, while allowing to the Spirit community in the inferior attributes, to judge him unworthy of those more exalted. For all the divine attributes, whether named or conceived, are of like rank one with another, in that they are not distinguishable in respect of the signification of their subject. For the appellation of the good does not lead our minds to one subject, and that of the wise, or the mighty, or the righteous, to another. But the thing to which all the attributes point is one, and if you speak of God, you signify the same whom you understood by the other attributes. If then all the attributes ascribed to the divine nature are of equal force as regards their designation of the subject, leading our minds to the same subject in various aspects, what reason is there that one, while allowing to the Spirit community with the Father and the Son in the other attributes, should exclude him from the Godhead alone? It is absolutely necessary either to allow to him community in this also, or not to admit his community in the others. For if he is worthy in the case of those attributes, he is surely not less worthy in this. But if he is less, according to their phrase, so that he is excluded from community with the Father and the Son in the attribute of Godhead, neither is he worthy to share in any other of the attributes which belong to God. For the attributes, when rightly understood and mutually compared by that notion which we contemplate in each case, will be found to imply nothing less than the appellation of God. And a proof of this is that many even of the inferior existences are called by this very name. Further, the divine scripture is not sparing in this use of the name, even in the case of things incongruous, as when it names idols by the appellation of God. For it says, "Let the gods that have not made the heavens and the earth perish, and be cast down beneath the earth." and all the gods of the heathen are devils, and the witch in her incantations, when she brings up for Saul the spirits that he sought for, says that she saw gods. And again, Balaam, being an augur and a seer, and engaging in divination and having obtained for himself the instruction of devils and magical augury, is said in Scripture to receive counsel from God. One may show by collecting many instances of the same kind from the divine Scripture that this attribute has no supremacy over the other attributes which are proper to God, seeing that, as has been said, we find it predicated in an equivocal sense, even of things incongruous. But we are nowhere taught in Scripture that the names of the holy, the incorruptible, the righteous, the good, are made common to things unworthy. If, then, they do not deny that the Holy Spirit has community with the Father and the Son in those attributes which, in their sense of special excellence, are piously predicated only of the divine nature, what reason is there to pretend that he is excluded from community in this only, wherein it was shown that, by an equivocal use, even devils and idols share? But they say that this appellation is indicative of nature, and that, as the nature of the Spirit is not common to the Father and the Son, for this reason neither does he partake in the community of this attribute. Let them show, then, whereby they discern this diversity of nature. For if it were possible that the divine nature should be contemplated in its absolute sense, and that we should find by appearances what is and what is not proper to it, we should surely have no need of other arguments or evidence for the comprehension of the question. But since it is exalted above the understanding of the questioners, and we have to argue from some particular evidence about those things which evade our knowledge, it is absolutely necessary for us to be guided to the investigation of the divine nature by its operations. If, then, we see that the operations which are wrought by the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit differ one from the other, we shall conjecture from the different character of the operations that the natures which operate are also different. For it cannot be that things which differ in their very nature should agree in the form of their operation. Fire does not chill nor ice give warmth, but their operations are distinguished together with the difference between their natures. If, on the other hand, we understand that the operation of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is one, differing or varying in nothing, the oneness of their nature must needs be inferred from the identity of their operation. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit alike give sanctification and life, and light and comfort, and all similar graces. And let no one attribute the power of sanctification in an especial sense to the Spirit, when he hears the Saviour in the Gospel saying to the Father concerning his disciples, "Father, sanctify them in thy name." So too, all the other gifts are wrought in those who are worthy, alike by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Every grace and power, guidance, life, comfort, the change to immortality, the passage to liberty, and every other boon that exists which descends to us. But the order of things which is above us, alike in the region of intelligence and in that of sense, if by what we know we may form conjectures about those things also which are above us, is itself established within the operation and power of the Holy Spirit, every man receiving the benefit according to his own desert and need. For, although the arrangement and ordering of things above our nature is obscure to our sense, yet one may more reasonably infer, by the things which we know, that in them too the power of the Spirit works, than that it is banished from the order existing in the things above us. For he who asserts the latter view advances his blasphemy in a naked and unseemly shape, without being able to support his absurd opinion by any argument. But he who agrees that those things which are above us are also ordered by the power of the Spirit, with the Father and the Son, makes his assertion on this point with the support of clear evidence from his own life. For as the nature of man is compounded of body and soul, and the angelic nature has for its portion life without a body, if the Holy Spirit worked only in the case of bodies, and the soul were not capable of receiving the grace that comes from him, one might perhaps infer from this, if the intellectual and incorporeal nature which is in us were above the power of the Spirit, that the angelic life too was in no need of his grace. But if the gift of the Holy Spirit is principally a grace of the soul, and the constitution of the soul is linked by its intellectuality and invisibility to the angelic life, What person who knows how to see a consequence would not agree that every intellectual nature is governed by the ordering of the Holy Spirit? For since it is said, "The angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven," and it is not possible to behold the person of the Father otherwise than by fixing the sight upon it through his image, and the image of the person of the Father is the only begotten, and to him again no man can draw near whose mind has not been illumined by the Holy Spirit, what else is shown from this but that the Holy Spirit is not separated from any operation which is wrought by the Father and the Son? Thus, the identity of operation in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit shows plainly the undistinguishable character of their substance. So that even if the name of Godhead does indicate nature, the community of substance shows that this appellation is properly applied also to the Holy Spirit. But I know not how these makers up of all sorts of arguments bring the appellation of Godhead to be an indication of nature, as though they had not heard from the Scripture that it is a matter of appointment in which way nature does not arise. For Moses was appointed as a god of the Egyptians, since he who gave him the oracles, etc., spoke thus to him, "I have given thee as a god to Pharaoh." Thus the force of the appellation is the indication of some power, either of oversight or of operation. But the divine nature itself, as it is, remains unexpressed by all the names that are conceived for it, as our doctrine declares. For in learning that he is beneficent and a judge, good and just, and all else of the same kind, we learn diversities of his operations, but we are none the more able to learn by our knowledge of his operations the nature of him who works. For when one gives a definition of any one of these attributes and of the nature to which the names are applied, he will not give the same definition of both, and of things of which the definition is different, the nature is also distinct. Indeed, the substance is one thing which no definition has been found to express, and the significance of the names employed concerning it varies, as the names are given from some operation or accident. Now the fact that there is no distinction in the operations we learn from the community of the attributes, but of the difference in respect of nature we find no clear proof, the identity of operations indicating rather, as we said, community of nature. If then Godhead is a name derived from operation, as we say that the operation of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit is one, so we say that the Godhead is one. Or if, according to the view of the majority, Godhead is indicative of nature, since we cannot find any diversity in their nature, we not unreasonably define the Holy Trinity to be of one Godhead. But if any one were to call this appellation indicative of dignity, I cannot tell by what reasoning he drags the word to this significance. Since, however, one may hear many saying things of this kind, in order that the zeal of its opponents may not find a ground for attacking the truth, we go out of our way with those who take this view to consider such an opinion, and say that even if the name does denote dignity, in this case too the appellation will properly befit the Holy Spirit. For the attribute of kingship denotes all dignity, and our God, it says, is king from everlasting. But the Son, having all things which are the Father's, is himself proclaimed a king by Holy Scripture. Now the divine Scripture says that the Holy Spirit is the unction of the only begotten, interpreting the dignity of the Spirit by a transference of the terms commonly used in this world. For as in ancient days, in those who were advanced to kingship, the token of this dignity was the unction which was applied to them, and when this took place, there was thenceforth a change from private and humble estate to the superiority of rule, and he who was deemed worthy of this grace received after his anointing another name, being called, instead of an ordinary man, the anointed of the Lord, for this reason, that the dignity of the Holy Spirit might be more clearly shown to men, he was called by the Scripture the sign of the kingdom, and unction, whereby we are taught that the Holy Spirit shares in the glory and kingdom of the only begotten Son of God. For as in Israel it was not permitted to enter upon the kingdom without the unction being previously given, so the word, by a transference of the terms in use among ourselves, indicates the equality of power, showing that not even the kingdom of the Son is received without the dignity of the Holy Spirit. And for this reason he is properly called Christ, since this name gives the proof of his inseparable and indivisible conjunction with the Holy Spirit. If then the only begotten God is the anointed, and the Holy Spirit is his unction, and the appellation of the anointed points to the kingly authority, and the anointing is the token of his kingship, then the Holy Spirit shares also in his dignity. If, therefore, they say that the attribute of Godhead is significative of dignity, and the Holy Spirit is shown to share in this last quality, it follows that he who partakes in the dignity will also partake in the name, which represents it. End of On the Holy Trinity and of the Godhead of the Holy Spirit by Gregory of Nyssa. On Not Three Gods by Gregory of Nyssa. To Ablabius. Ye that are strong with all might in the inner man ought by rights to carry on the struggle against the enemies of the truth, and not to shrink from the task, that we fathers may be gladdened by the noble toil of our sons, for this is the prompting of the law of nature. But as you turn your ranks and send against us the assaults of those darts which are hurled by the opponents of the truth, and demand that their hot-burning coals and their shafts sharpened by knowledge falsely so called should be quenched with the shield of faith by us old men, we accept your command and make ourselves an example of obedience in order that you may yourself give us the just requital on like commands, Ablabius, noble soldier of Christ, if we should ever summon you to such a contest. In truth, the question you propound to us is no small one, nor such that but small harm will follow if it meets with insufficient treatment. For by the force of the question we are at first sight compelled to accept one or other of two erroneous opinions, and either to say there are three gods, which is unlawful, or not to acknowledge the Godhead of the Son and the Holy Spirit, which is impious and absurd. The argument which you state is something like this: Peter, James, and John, being in one human nature, are called three men, and there is no absurdity in describing those who are united in nature, if they are more than one, by the plural number of the name derived from their nature. If then, in the above case, custom admits this, and no one forbids us to speak of those who are two as two, or those who are more than two as three, how is it that in the case of our statements of the mysteries of the faith, though confessing the three persons and acknowledging no difference of nature between them, we are in some sense at variance with our confession when we say that the Godhead of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost is one, and yet forbid men to say there are three gods? The question is, as I said, very difficult to deal with, yet if we should be able to find anything that may give support to the uncertainty of our mind, so that it may no longer totter and waver in this monstrous dilemma, it would be well. On the other hand, even if our reasoning be found unequal to the problem, we must keep forever firm and unmoved the tradition which we have received by succession from the fathers, and seek from the Lord the reason which is the advocate of our faith. And if this be found by any of those endowed with grace, we must give thanks to him who bestowed the grace. But if not, we shall nonetheless, on those points which have been determined, hold our faith unchangeably. What then is the reason that, when we count one by one those who are exhibited to us in one nature, we ordinarily name them in the plural and speak of so many men, instead of calling them all one? While in the case of the divine nature, our doctrinal definition rejects the plurality of gods, at once enumerating the persons, and at the same time not admitting the plural signification. Perhaps one might seem to touch the point if he were to say, speaking offhand to straightforward people, that the definition refused to reckon gods in any number to avoid any resemblance to the polytheism of the heathen, lest, if we too were to enumerate the deity, not in the singular but in the plural, as they are accustomed to do, there might be supposed to be also some community of doctrine. The answer, I say, if made to people of a more guileless spirit, might seem to be of some weight, but in the case of the others, who require that one of the alternatives they propose should be established, either that we should not acknowledge the Godhead in three persons, or that if we do, we should speak of those who share in the same Godhead as three, this answer is not such as to furnish any solution of the difficulty. and hence we must needs make our reply at greater length, tracing out the truth as best we may, for the question is no ordinary one. We say then, to begin with, that the practice of calling those who are not divided in nature by the very name of their common nature in the plural, and saying they are many men, is a customary abuse of language, and that it would be much the same to say they are many human natures. And the truth of this we may see from the following instance. When we address any one, we do not call him by the name of his nature, in order that no confusion may result from the community of the name, as would happen if every one of those who hear it were to think that he himself was the person addressed, because the call is made not by the proper appellation, but by the common name of their nature. But we separate him from the multitude by using that name which belongs to him as his own, that I mean which signifies the particular subject. Thus, there are many who have shared in the nature, many disciples, say, or apostles or martyrs, but the man in them all is one, since, as has been said, the term man does not belong to the nature of the individual as such, but to that which is common. For Luke is a man, or Stephen is a man, but it does not follow that if any one is a man, he is therefore Luke or Stephen, but the idea of the persons admits of that separation which is made by the peculiar attributes considered in each severally, and when they are combined is presented to us by means of number, yet their nature is one, at union in itself, and an absolutely indivisible unit, not capable of increase by addition, or of diminution by subtraction, but in its essence being and continually remaining one, inseparable, even though it appear in plurality, continuous, complete, and not divided with the individuals who participate in it. And as we speak of a people, or a mob, or an army, or an assembly, in the singular, in every case, while each of these is conceived as being in plurality, so, according to the more accurate expression, man would be said to be one, even though those who are exhibited to us in the same nature make up a plurality. Thus it would be much better to correct our erroneous habit, so as no longer to extend to a plurality the name of the nature, than by our bondage to habit to transfer to our statements concerning God the error which exists in the above case. But since the correction of the habit is impracticable, for how could you persuade anyone not to speak of those who are exhibited in the same nature as many men? Indeed, in every case habit is a thing hard to change. We are not so far wrong in not going contrary to the prevailing habit in the case of the lower nature, since no harm results from the mistaken use of the name. But in the case of the statement concerning the divine nature, the various use of terms is no longer so free from danger, for that which is of small account is in these subjects no longer a small matter. Therefore, we must confess one God according to the testimony of Scripture. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord. Even though the name of Godhead extends through the Holy Trinity. This, I say, according to the account we have given in the case of human nature, in which we have learnt that it is improper to extend the name of the nature by the mark of plurality. We must, however, more carefully examine the name of Godhead, in order to obtain, by means of the significance involved in the word, some help towards clearing up the question before us. Most men think that the word Godhead is used in a peculiar degree in respect of nature, just as the heaven, or the sun, or any other of the constituent parts of the universe are denoted by proper names which are significant of the subjects, so they say in the case of the supreme and divine nature, the word Godhead is fitly adapted to that which it represents to us as a kind of special name. We, on the other hand, following the suggestions of Scripture, have learnt that the nature is unnameable and unspeakable, and we say that every term either invented by the custom of men or handed down to us by the Scriptures is indeed explanatory of our conceptions of the divine nature, but does not include the signification of that nature itself. And it may be shown without much difficulty that this is the case. For all other terms which are used of the creation may be found, even without analysis of their origin, to be applied to the subjects accidentally, because we are content to denote the things in any way by the word applied to them, so as to avoid confusion in our knowledge of the things signified. But all the terms that are employed to lead us to the knowledge of God have comprehended in them each its own meaning, and you cannot find any word among the terms especially applied to God, which is without a distinct sense. Hence it is clear that, by any of the terms we use, the divine nature itself is not signified, but some one of its surroundings is made known. For we say, it may be, that the deity is incorruptible or powerful, or whatever else we are accustomed to say of him. But in each of these terms we find a peculiar sense, fit to be understood or asserted of the divine nature, yet not expressing that which the nature is in its essence. For the subject, whatever it may be, is incorruptible, but our conception of incorruptibility is this, that that which is not resolved into decay. So, when we say that he is incorruptible, we declare what his nature does not suffer, but we do not express what that is which does not suffer corruption. Thus, again, if we say that he is the giver of life, though we show by that appellation what he gives, we do not by that word declare what that is which gives it. And by the same reasoning, we find that all else which results from the significance involved in the names expressing the divine attributes either forbids us to conceive what we ought not to conceive of the divine nature, or teaches us that which we ought to conceive of it, but does not include an explanation of the nature itself. Since then, as we perceive the varied operations of the power above us, we fashion our appellations from the several operations that are known to us, and as we recognize as one of these that operation of surveying and inspection, or as one might call it, beholding, whereby he surveys all things and overlooks them all, discerning our thoughts and even entering by his power of contemplation into those things which are not visible, we suppose that Godhead, or Theotes, is so called from thea, or beholding, and that he who is our theates, or beholder, by customary use.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.